Hi, I'm Terry Gross, the host of Fresh Air. We often talk about religion on Fresh Air, not to convert anyone, but to have an ongoing conversation about how different religious traditions address the most fundamental questions about life, death, joy, and suffering. On these CDs, you'll hear highlights of interviews with people for whom faith is a central part of life, and people who've devoted their lives to studying sacred texts. But you'll also hear from others who've left their faith, who don't believe in God, and who fear religion often seems to do more harm than good. Karen Armstrong has become famous for her books about the religions of the world, including A History of God. But before she became a scholar of religion, she was a nun. She entered the convent in 1962 as an idealistic 17-year-old, expecting to lead a life of real meaning and to find a radical freedom within the convent. The religious life also offered a welcome escape from teenage social demands. But life in the convent wasn't what she expected. Her community was founded in the 19th century, and customs that made sense then struck her now as cultural relics of the Victorian age, lacking real spiritual value. And she chafed against the emphasis on obedience. In 1969, 7 years after entering the convent, she suffered a breakdown, feeling she had failed to find God. This interview with her was recorded in 2004, after the publication of her memoir, The Spiral Staircase, about leaving the convent and re-entering the world. When you were in the convent, you started studying at Oxford University, where you were taught to think critically and challenge all assumptions, and then you'd have to go home to the convent where you were taught to be obedient and never challenge. And it's impossible to reconcile those two worlds, isn't it?
Yes, and I was feeling myself continually in that first year at Oxford split apart, because part of me was absolutely reveling and luxuriating in the freedom to read books and read whatever I wanted, knowing this was my job. It was just intoxicating to me. I loved it. And yet, on the other hand, there was this deadly weight of disapproval if you sort of wanted to try out your newly honed critical skills on the nuns at home, because we were supposed still to be obedient. And I wanted to stay. There was no sense that I was yearning to escape. I was terrified of leaving, quite terrified. And to leave seemed, even to think of leaving was like, it was like breaching a taboo. It was so monumental and awful a step. But eventually, at the end of that year, I had a breakdown. It was only a mild breakdown, but it became quite clear to all of us, my superiors and myself, that I couldn't continue.
What were the symptoms of the breakdown?
Well, I was constantly crying. I cried throughout my whole religious life like a broken waterspout, I have to say. I just kept bursting into tears. We were told that if we weren't finding life impossibly difficult, we weren't trying hard enough. So they must have been delighted with me, because I never stopped crying. And I'm not a crier, really, these days. But I think it was a great strain. And we were all also convulsed with giggles, too. I mean, one of us would start giggling at something utterly unremarkable, and the whole lot of us, it would go like almost a disease, a contagion. We were on the brink of real strain, I think. In that last year, too, I had had fainting attacks and also terrible nosebleeds and vomiting. And then finally, I just collapsed. I was supposed to be serving in the dining hall, and I just passed out. And I cried and cried and cried and said, kept on saying, I can't do it. I can't do this.
Well, some of the problems, the physical problems that you described, the fainting spells, the vomiting, some of this was like symptoms of what was later diagnosed as epilepsy. But at the time,
yes,
no one knew that that's what it was. And so you were diagnosed with hysteria. It was considered to be a nervous reaction to your life.
Yes.
Do you think, had you known that the problem was epilepsy, that you might have stayed in the convent?
No, I wouldn't have stayed, because there was another thing that was eating away at me corrosively throughout my religious life, was that I was unable to pray. And that is obviously a drawback for a nun. I I can now concentrate on my work for hours at a time without even noticing the time passing. But as soon as I would go into the convent chapel to begin my meditation every morning, my mind would just go everywhere. And nobody else seemed to have these difficulties. I was waiting to encounter God, and I never did. And I also harboured secret doubts about, you know, was there a God even? Who could tell that Jesus had been God and man at the same time? And a nun who had these kind of doubts could not be going to be a good nun. So there was this, despite the epilepsy was an added problem, it became a monumental problem once I'd left the convent. But I don't think that I would have stayed.
You came back into the world in 1969 at the height of the counterculture. And, you know, the counterculture was in part about losing inhibitions. It was about sexual freedom. You'd been raised in what you describe as absolute physical restraint. What were some of the most baffling new things going on in the world when you got out of the convent in 1969?
Well, there I was in my Oxford college, surrounded by students who were demonstrating their rage and protest with something called the establishment or the system, and carrying placards and protesting. I mean, I had been schooled in an institution where young people were subservient and almost cravenly subservient. These young people were confident. They were clearly sexually involved. And in my days, before the contraceptive pill, sexual intercourse was a tremendously dangerous and risky enterprise, not to mention a major mortal sin. And this didn't seem to worry these young people at all. And they all wore these kind of raggedy clothes or skirts right up to their thighs. And it was a sort of carnival. And I had no notion what was going on. I remember going to my first party and hearing a song and trying to show an interest and say, who are these people? And everybody gaped at me and said, well, they're the Beatles, of course. And I'd never knowingly heard one of their records. And I thought they were named after those little insects that crawled around. And I had that all that had to be explained. While all this carnival of joyous 60s exuberance was going on, I was looking on bewildered and also sad because I just felt so appallingly sad about having left the convent and having to relinquish that old dream and feeling a terrible sense of failure.
Well, you must have felt so bad, so lonely, not fitting either into the world of the convent or into the world outside it.
Indeed, and I felt that I would never fit into the world. I didn't see how I could. And then I started having these strange attacks, which subsequently proved to be epileptic, where I'd be overcome with sheer dread or an absolute sense of paralyzing terror, almost a hallucinatory terror. So you could almost glimpse somebody standing beside me, or I'd set off to go somewhere and find that I'd myself ending up somewhere in a completely different place. And it seemed to me that I had schooled myself to reject the world, and now I couldn't get back into it, that the world and I were utterly incompatible, and that my mind was splintering under the strain, and I really feared for my sanity, because this epilepsy wasn't diagnosed for another 5 or 6 years.
The doctor who did diagnose your epilepsy told you that a lot of people who become religious have this form of epilepsy. It's temporal lobe epilepsy.
Yes.
Have you looked into that to see what the connection is?
Yes. I think epilepsy of the temporal lobe it's the seat, I believe, of the memory and many of the emotions, and so you are living constantly on the brink of things. Dostoevsky suffered from it, and he writes about it in his book called The Idiot. When you're in convulsion, your mind can sort of explode, and it looks as though you're seeing God. And I have experienced that once or twice, but I knew this was only, by that time the epilepsy had been diagnosed, and I knew this was only a neurological thunderstorm. And the sense of evil and fear and terror I had could easily have been seen as the devil or a demonic presence. So Van Gogh had it, and you see, I think, in some of his landscapes with those tortured, writhing olive trees or that brilliantly swirling, menacing, starry sky, you see a world that's slightly out of kilter.
It's interesting, you know, I've been talking to you for several years now on Fresh Air, and I always think of you as so authoritative and having such a kind of organized life, and reading about your life and the problems that you had and the failures that you had early on with your dissertation, which for very complicated reasons wasn't accepted because of the guy who was your... who was the judge of it. And, you know, you got fired from a teaching job. Things were just, like, not working out. And it's understandable that at the time you thought that nothing was ever going to work out for you. And then, of all things, you started working on a TV documentary series for Channel 4 in England about religion. And that's where you really learned that scholarship was really religion scholarship was your calling, and some people might find it really paradoxical that it was through television that you discovered the importance of scholarship in your life, that religion scholarship.
Yes, I mean I'd never thought by this time after a few years of leaving the convent, I gave up religion altogether. I wanted nothing more to do with it. And if I saw people reading a religious book on a train or something, I felt quite sort of ill with horror at the thought of all that awful stuff, as I dismissed it. But then after a series, as you say, of career disasters, I ended up in television, found that I did start making these skeptical television programs. My first programs were extremely skeptical, and that was very suitable for London, which is a very secular city. Britain's a very secular country. People look at religion with disdain. And I did a documentary series on St. Paul, and yet, at the same time as I was pointing out the evils of religion and the disorders of religion, which I chronicled almost, it was cathartic for me to get all that off my chest and liberating. But also I found myself, much to my astonishment, being drawn through my study of St. Paul to a much great affection for this pugnacious apostle. And similarly, with the other I began to see that there had been a lot in my religious background that had been very limited. I encountered for the first time when I was working in Jerusalem on this project on St. Paul, Judaism and Islam, about which I knew nothing. My religious horizons had been wholly Christian. And I began to find that there were in these other Abrahamic traditions things and elements and visions and ideals that I could really relate to. And so slowly, it was by infinitesimal degrees, I began to see that there was more in religion than I'd imagined, and found myself gradually brought back through study, through television initially, into a religious orbit again, and was beginning to look increasingly as the years went by a little more favorably on it.
So if studying religion is a quest for meaning, and if you see religion itself as a quest for meaning, do you find yourself believing in the existence of a God? And if so, what shape does that God have?
No, I don't. I think belief, sorry to sound evasive, but I think belief is a red herring. Quite early on in my studies, I had the good fortune to talk to a Jewish scholar friend of mine, Chaim Maccabee, who's also an author, and he told me the story of Rabbi Hillel, the older contemporary of Jesus. And Hillel was approached by a group of pagans who said that they would convert to Judaism if the rabbi would recite the whole of the Torah while he stood on one leg. And Hillel stood on one leg and said, "Do not do unto others as you would not have done unto you. That's the Torah. The rest is commentary. Go and learn it." And I said to Chaim, well, what did he expect these pagans to believe? And he said, oh, easy to see, you were brought up Christian. You know, we don't care so much about belief. That was a wonderful gift to me, that moment, because I came to see that the golden rule is the essence of religion. If you live in that way, you become putting yourself on the back burner, looking into your own heart, finding what grieves and pains you, and not inflicting that grief and pain on other people. Do not do unto others. If we did this on a daily, hourly basis, we would be constantly transcending ourselves, going beyond ourselves, and getting glimpses of a sacred transcendent reality. And I suppose I'm with the Buddha, with Confucius, and also with Hillel there, who weren't going to give a great discourse on the nature of the divine or the sacred or the Tao or Nirvana. The Buddha always said these are improper questions. He said, behave in a certain way, live in a certain way, above all by compassion, and then you will know that this exists. And I myself, since I've been trying to live like that, and in fact it was my study that helped me to come to this perception, have found a sense of joy and purpose and enlargement of heart, though I'm by no means on some pinnacle. So I get intimations of this. For me, the personal God didn't work.
When you say personal God, do you mean a God you have a personal relationship with, or a God that's embodied in some kind of personhood that we could name that has a shape?
Yes.
The latter?
The latter, but mm-hmm. But I couldn't have a personal relationship with God because all these prayers, all my trying to talk to
right.
him, and I didn't get it. I didn't do it. Now, that's fine. I'm not in the business of dismantling other people's faith. If the personal God works for you and opens doors, then this is just wonderful, and I applaud it. The test is that it leads you to practical compassion, because that's what all the world religions tell us. I think, and after all, God is what we call God, what we call the divine or the sacred, is indescribable. It goes beyond our little theological systems. It is literally transcendent. It is infinite and cannot therefore be defined, a word that means to set limits upon. We can all only have these glimpses, but we can know in our hearts a transcendence that changes us and that makes our life worth living. The Buddhists would say that this transcendence is not supernatural at all. You see, they'd say it was quite natural to humanity to have this sense of wonder and awe and a fulfillment that takes you beyond the limitations of your mundane secular self.
Well, we're out of time, but I'm just going to ask you, this is a horrible thing to do, for a yes or no answer on this, because we're so out of time, but do you still feel uncomfortable in the world, or do you feel like you belong in the world now?
I do belong in the world, but I'm still a bit of an outsider, not married, writing about religion, living in a country that doesn't approve of religion, and yet I have sort of yet too, my work has brought me not only to the center of my life, but also to the center of people's concerns in this religiously troubled age. So, yes, I do belong to the world now, more than I ever thought I would, though I've never entirely fitted in. I'm still a bit of that solitary nun.
After leaving the cast of Saturday Night Live, Julia Sweeney started creating and performing autobiographical monologues. In God Said Ha, she told the story of how she was diagnosed with cancer as her brother was dying of cancer. She managed to make the story both funny and moving. I recorded this interview with her in October 2006 about her monologue, Letting Go of God. It describes how she rededicated herself to the Catholic Church at the age of 38, but found the deeper she got, the more skeptical she became of the Bible and religion. She now considers herself an atheist. In this excerpt of Letting Go of God, Sweeney is describing her reactions to closely reading the Bible. She's found the Old Testament surprisingly disturbing and is looking forward to carefully reading the New Testament and meeting Jesus again as if it were for the first time. But once again, what she finds surprises her.
Well, first of all, Jesus was much angrier than I expected him to be. I mean, I knew he got angry with all those money changers in the temple, but I really had no idea that he was so angry so much of the time. And very impatient. Jesus says that he speaks in parables because the people, they just don't understand anything else. But the parables are often foggy and meaningless, and Jesus is snippy when even the disciples don't get them. He says to them, if you don't understand this parable, then how can you understand any parable? And are you incapable of understanding? I kept thinking, don't teach in parables then. It's not working. Even your staff doesn't understand them. Why don't you just say what you mean? And then there's family. I have to say that for me, the most deeply upsetting thing about Jesus is his family values, which is amazing when you think how there's so many groups out there who say they base their family values on the Bible. I mean, he seems to have no real close ties to his parents. He puts his mother off cruelly over and over again. At the wedding feast, he says to her, "Woman, what have I to do with you?" And once, while he was speaking to a crowd, Mary waited patiently off to the side to talk to him, and Jesus said to the disciples, "Send her away. You are my family now." Matthew, Mark, and Luke all tell this exact same story, but Mark actually tells us why Mary was there to see Jesus. He says Mary came to see Jesus to restrain him because the people were saying he's gone out of his mind. I kept thinking, yes, let's go get Jesus and get him some help.
An excerpt of Julia Sweeney's CD, Letting Go of God. Here's my interview with her. Before we get to how you lost your faith, let's get to how you had become more religious. And you describe in your monologue that at the age of 38, you had what I think some people would describe as a born-again experience, though you wouldn't have used those words. But could you describe that experience that you had?
I was raised Catholic, and I liked being Catholic, and I didn't think that Catholicism was the only way to be with God or anything, but I thought it was a good way to be with God, and I liked being Catholic. And then I went through this terrible breakup when I was 38, and I was in this 4-year relationship, and I completely expected to, you know, marry and raise children with this man, and then he abruptly, you know, called off the relationship.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.